Hello there guys, Billabo10000 here, bringing you another video game review. Today we're taking a look at the recently released demo for Balan Wonderworld, the Square Enix 3D platformer spearheaded by Yuji Naka, a renowned programmer and producer of the old Sonic games, you know, before the Sonic series became a laughingstock. In collaboration with legendary character designer Naoto Oshima, the guy behind Sonic's actual appearance, the hype behind this title has been quite something to behold. People want to see Yuji Naka develop titles like he used to. Many were hoping this would be a return to form for his work, and this demo had high expectations. However, from what I've seen, initial reception to Balan Wonderworld has not been positive to say the least. Pretty much all the big Nintendo tubers covering this game have expressed issues with the Switch port, big news outlets like Nintendo Life have slammed the title's demo, and I wanted to see for myself whether this game really is as bad as people have claimed. Because a lot of mainstream review outlets have actually given this demo positive remarks. Screen Rant released an article you can find down below where the first line is, "It's easy to tell, even before trying Balan Wonderworld on PlayStation 5, that the game is going to look pretty." They describe it as a feast for the eyes. And while the article does do a good job of explaining how the mechanics of the demo feel basic, I can't help but wonder what game they were looking at, as I don't see a visual feast. I see table scraps, and that's from the PC port. I'm also going to be taking a look at the Switch port to see just how far down the rabbit hole we can fall. What I'm trying to say is that this game's demo has been strangely divisive, and I'm here to give you guys my thoughts, feelings, impressions, and we'll go from there. Without further ado, let us begin. The Balan Wonderworld demo gives us access to 4 stages and 1 boss fight, as well as a hub area, the Isle of Tims. The hub is extremely bare bones. It's a single floating island with a couple of flower patches, a few Tims roaming around, and a weird wheel in the center. This is tied to the Tims farming mechanic, as you can feed Tims the collectibles you find in levels to, well, I don't actually know, make them like you more? These mechanics aren't explained, but I think the more you feed your Tims, the more they follow you, and if you stand by this wheel, your Tims will warp onto it and spin it. You can spin the wheel up to 500 times in the demo, unlocking various cosmetic upgrades for your hub area so your Tims can play happily. However, it has no bearing on the gameplay whatsoever, and loses its charm the moment you realize you can't actually interact with these items you're developing for your Tims. You can pick them up at least, and in my case, chuck the Tims right off the edge. Hello there. And that was the most fun I had in the hub. You can get the counter to 500 by just standing by the wheel before going AFK for 20 minutes. Pretty easy stuff. Now, on the PC version of this hub, all the assets are at least loaded in. Grass doesn't pop in, the draw distance is fair. On Switch, however, the draw distance is super low, so grass is constantly being loaded in on top of the textures, which is just bad optimization. And you'll note through this video that the Switch port, look, I'm gonna be blunt, it should not exist. Let's take this opening sequence from World 1. You get this opening cutscene with the barn splinters into pieces and the level forms around you, and on PC, it looks fine, smooth, perhaps even appealing? But on Switch, the textures are muddy, the frame rate tanks, it's just god awful to look at, and it doesn't get any better from there. For example, you can't interact with NPCs in the game. You go near them and they literally vanish from existence. Excuse me? What? Where are my friends? Where did they go? There was this massive farmer right here and now he's gone. Am I going mad? And why are they all dancing? They don't stop dancing. They're just in a constant state of celebration. I reached a checkpoint in World 2 and they're dancing for me. Why stop dancing, please? Oh, thank God the boss is dead. I saved the farmer. What's next? Oh God, a dance number. Fuck me. Now, before I get into the level design and the issues I found, I do want to address a few things that I think this demo does well, because yes, there are things I actually liked about this title. The opening movie cinematic was gorgeous. It's where the entire budget went, but I can't be mad because it gives really strong Aladdin genie vibes, and Balan is just a joy to see in action. The other CG cutscenes in-game, such as the opening cutscenes for your two main characters, as well as the montage sequence with the farmer before the first world's boss arena, also look really good. Depending on the character you choose, the CG will change to accommodate, which I think is very cool. That being said, the cutscene for the male protagonist story-wise was dumb. Your character does this cool dance, whatever, but then gets upset when people ask to hang out with him? Why is he suddenly emo? This makes no sense. At least the female protagonist has a reason to be upset, as she's being talked about behind her back by the maids employed at her house. Upper class issues, relatable, am I right? The music in this game is also really catchy. The opening world's music is simple but effective, but I personally enjoyed the tracks from Chapter 4 and Chapter 6, as they offered a different style that I just vibed with. Balin's theme during the Balin bouts is also fun to listen to, but not when paired with the Balin bouts themselves. We will get to that. The song after you beat the first boss, though, it was cheesy and didn't match up with the tone of the scene. You have this weirdly emotional sequence, the music has these beautiful vocals, and then dance number! Yay! Tonally, this game is just weird, and well, that's honestly it for what I enjoyed, because God, I have never had a more underwhelming experience playing a video game in my life, and we're just gonna dissect things one at a time, so let's just get straight to it. First off, the character animations. Who the hell gave the green light for this game's running animation? The characters are waving their arms around like they're about to knock somebody's lights out, yet they move at a snail's pace. It's like they're running on ice constantly. But worse than that are the jumps. The game's jump feels clunky and stiff, hard to control, it's not satisfying. And in a 3D platformer, jumping is kind of important. And sometimes, you can't even jump. Let me tell you about this game's costume mechanics and control scheme, because fuck me, I don't understand how anyone thought this was a good idea. Okay, aside from your movement, which is controlled by movement keys, and your ability to switch costumes, every other button assigned to the game is tied to your action ability. In other words, when playing on a Nintendo Switch, A, B, X, and Y all are assigned to jump. And if you pick up a costume that has a special ability, the ability is also tied to all four of those buttons. For example, you pick up the Tornado Wolf ability. You can press any of those buttons to do your Tornado Spin Jump, whose animation is also rigid in a ripoff of Crash's spin attack with a dash of looking like an Incineroar fursuit, but I digress. Where this one button controls everything nonsense gets really funny though is in level 2, as you collect this dragon suit that allows you to breathe fire by pressing the action button. But your special action and your jump are tied to the same button, so if you wear a costume that has a special action that isn't a jump, you can't jump. You have to switch costumes to one that can jump if you want to jump. So let me just reiterate, with certain costumes, you lose the ability to jump in a 3D platformer. You have four buttons. You could assign jump to B and a costume special action to A, but no! You tie every single action to a single button and it makes the gameplay feel stilted and archaic in design. This is some 90s level control scheme, not the 2020s. And hell, if switching costumes was quick, it'd be fine, but the animation pauses your character for an entire second, and that adds up in gameplay. It doesn't sound like a lot of time, but it feels like a lot of time. And even better, because of how they programmed these buttons, even the menus follow the same fucking gimmick. If you enter the options menu, the only way to go back is by pressing go back to the previous menu. You can't just press B to go back or something intuitive like that. Seeing the prompt press A, B, X, Y to enter is genuinely fucking baffling. I had to pause for a minute. And for some godforsaken reason, if you want to pause the game on PC, the pause button isn't escape like every other game. No, that would be too easy. It's the bloody middle mouse button. Why is the middle mouse button pause? There are people out there who probably don't even know there's a middle mouse button if you push down your scroll wheel. And what about trackpad users? I don't even know what they pause with. Now, this would all be somewhat fine if the gameplay was actually interesting, but the costume mechanic, the 80 different costumes that practically advertise this game, For the most part, they don't need to be in the game. For example, the first two costumes in-game give you a spin attack and a Yoshi-style flutter jump. Why do you need to collect those abilities? I'd rather just play a Crash Bandicoot or Yoshi game, as they give me those very basic platforming tools right off of the bat. You have to equip the god-awfully named Pounding Pig Suit to ground pound. Mario can ground pound for free, I'll just go play Odyssey then. The reason why 3D platformers are so beloved is because the main characters often have a variety of movement options at their disposal from the get-go. This is not the case in Balan Wonderworld. I've already mentioned the dragon suit with its flame attack that won't let you jump. There's a box fox suit that randomly turns you into a box, but keeps your momentum, and I found zero use for it aside from comically falling off cliffs. And in Chapter 6, you get this cog print suit that lets you activate cogs to move platforms, but you could have done the same thing mechanically by just having a lever or a spin wheel that the protagonist can interact with. You didn't need to make a suit around that concept. That being said, there are a couple of suits I actually liked. The sheep suit lets you fly over fans and slow your descent, which helped me to absolutely destroy this demo in terms of breaking how you would collect certain Balan statues. The air acrobat suit was also cool, as the homing attack it comes in is very Sonic style. And the pumpkin suit with the Rayman-style arms was entertaining to use. But for the most part, these suits don't enhance the gameplay. They simply give you the tools that better 3D platformers let you start out with. This is very baby's first platformer, but I don't even think kids would enjoy this. Platforming is so simple I had to go out of my way to try and die. Towards the end of World 2, I almost got excited at a brief area that looks like I'd have to walk carefully to not fall into the void, only for the holes to fill in with flowers the moment I got to the walkway. Why? Why? And the issue with Balan Wonderworld is that the people excited for this game are the adults who have been following Yuji Naka's career and were hoping for a return to form. This feels like a project that shouldn't have been hyped, and yet it was. Gameplay-wise, the levels are so simple, there's barely any challenge to face in the early game. Enemies are easy to kill, you can jump on or tornado attack any enemy pretty easily. That also goes for the main boss of this demo, which was laughably easy. It feels like the enemies are an afterthought, none of them feel particularly interesting, they look like reject Kingdom Hearts Heartless. The main villain, who we don't know anything about by the way, looks like a darker, shadowy version of Infinite from Sonic Forces, and with how much this game focuses on hearts and heart iconography, I think Kingdom Hearts comparisons are shockingly apt. The first boss of this game is a corrupted farmer who fell into despair and got turned into a tornado, furry, wolf, heartless creature. I'm just waiting for Xehanort to pop in and start ranting about darkness again. I want to actually break down a couple of short gameplay moments that I found baffling from a design decision. First off, a majority of the puzzles in the first levels are literally just push a button down, door opens, cutscene plays, you win. It's not even a puzzle. There's one instance where you have to guide a ball to a hole, but it's laughably simple and takes advantage of a mechanic that made me feel visually ill. And that is that this game, for whatever reason, after you collect the first Balan statue in level 1, proceeds to warp the game world's perspective from being a flat area to being on a circular tilt. So you'll walk away from an area and it'll begin to slide away like you're running along a ball, kind of like the Sonic 3 special stages. I initially thought this was a glitch because it looked awful and wasn't a thing for the first portion of gameplay, but then in the second level, with the aforementioned ball guiding puzzle, I realized it was a purposeful effect, and no, I don't get motion sick, I never have in games before, but this made me feel genuinely nauseous. I suspect the perspective shift was to highlight that we're in somebody's mind, Psychonaut style, and of course things wouldn't be a flat plane, but it doesn't need to exist. And that ball puzzle is the only time in the demo where the perspective shift really comes into play. But then it's gone in future levels, so what the fuck? There are also these portals in each of the levels that can teleport you to other portals, and their introduction is insanely dumb. You have a cutscene of a rabbit going through one mirror and coming out of the other being on the other side of a fence, right next to the portal it went in. There's nothing wrong with this. but it's fucking boring. There are ways you could implement that feature of teleportation into a puzzle. Like, you enter a portal, and then you appear on a floating island further away, and that's where the rest of the level takes place. It would make you feel like you're actually making progress, but having you just go around a fence when you could simply jump over it is bland, for lack of a better term. There's also this instance in World 6 of the portal switching between two locations that are right next to each other, that if you have any form of jump power up, you can just jump between anyway. So why bother even having this switching mechanic if it's obsolete based on the power ups you've given the player already? And can we talk about the Balan bouts? You'll randomly find a golden hat in each level, which will summon Balan. You will then be taken to a featureless void and told to do some QTEs, because we love quick time events in this household. Balan will then destroy random stuff, and then destroy a big crystal that I think represents despair, and if you did it perfectly, you get a trophy. These sequences could have been so much more. First off, why do they take place in a featureless void? You could have made them take place in the world your player is currently in, using the skyboxes from those worlds to add some flavor. These could have been great railgun shooter sections, for example, which would seemingly fit Balan's character design perfectly. Instead, we have to press buttons at the right time, and it's so low effort. The only interesting bout comes from Chapter 6, where you're fighting the main antagonist for some reason, but that also only serves to highlight how fucking bland and non-threatening the bad guy is. If Balan can beat him up without issue, why do we have to fear him? And can I just talk about how dumb the idea of only being able to collect costumes if you have a key is? The keys are right next to the costumes 9 out of 10 times, and they respawn. Just give us a location to collect the costumes without this key business. The game is padded with bullshit ideas and executions that just fall flat on their faces, and this isn't even taking into account the fact that you can literally catch T-Pose animation issues on all platforms. But most impressively, the Switch port. Take a look at this cutscene of the first boss, and pause, there it is. Or the trailer from the game on Switch, and pause. That's a T-pose right there, ladies and gentlemen. This game is not finished. This game is not polished. This game is flawed. And conspiracy theory time? I think it's because this title was meant to be a mobile game. There's no proof of that, but certain aspects of the gameplay and graphics point me in that direction. The single button inputs would make complete sense for a touchscreen. The fact that costumes are simple and the gameplay is so bland would work well on mobile because there's only so much you can do on there. The downscaled graphics would make sense on mobile too. These brief text boxes in levels when you interact with Balan look right out of a mobile game. I'm not going mad, am I? Leave your thoughts on this conspiracy theory down below. Overall, this game is not ready for consumers. It baffles me that people find this game to be in an acceptable state. Yeah, you can say, I don't really care, as long as I have fun, it's all good. But shouldn't we be striving for better quality? There's nothing wrong with enjoying something that's flawed, or even bad. I'll never tell anyone to change their opinions on something they love, but this could genuinely be so much better than it actually is, and it's that pure missed potential that really saddens me about Balan Wonderworld. If you do want to consider trying the demo out, please do not try the Switch port for the life of you. At the very least, the PlayStation and PC ports are functional. The Switch port is a buggy, glorified mess, and I want you guys to have the best chance at potentially enjoying this game, even at the expense of a platform I hold dear. Will I be picking this game up when it launches? No, God no, God please no, I never want to play this game again. At the very least, I'm not playing it at full price. This is the sort of title I might consider buying if I see it at like, I don't know, 95% off? Yeah, a real shame this was a game many were looking forward to. If you're looking for a 3D platformer with a lot of charm that has a similar aesthetic but is actually good and highly acclaimed, I'll recommend A Hat in Time. I still need to play it myself, but the gameplay is 3D platforming fun, and you'll be supporting indie devs to boot. Thank you for watching, guys. If you enjoyed, be sure to leave a like, comment, and subscribe. Check out my previous video where I reviewed the first ever Uncharted game. It was great fun. Or you can check out my last demo review of Monster Hunter Rise. I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye.